Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Seed Story Cup 5. This is Nimshin. I'm here with TJ and Ecop to bring the next match, which is Jackie Chan versus Gaara. An exciting match, but first, TJ and Ecop, like you've guys been hanging around and having fun, playing some Hearthstone, playing some other games, watching. How are you doing?
It's fun. You know, just Dan explained it really well earlier. He called it a think tank. And downstairs, you watch the players watch these games, and every single time, at least like five of them have different play.
Yeah.
Like every single thing that they pick apart, when it comes to like deck picking order, when it comes to like the decks that they brought, when it comes to card choices, it's crazy. Just by sitting downstairs and listening, you learn so much.
Yeah, definitely. Everybody has a different opinion, and Ecop, you are already through today free. Just chilling today, resting, preparing for tomorrow?
Oh yeah, definitely. I'm watching some matches, casting some, also looking back at some VODs of how the casters casted my match, my matches.
Did you like it?
Yeah, they talked a lot of trash, but obviously that's a given, right?
Did I cast your match? Did I cast?
No, it was Frode. Like Tempestorm guys, mostly. RDU and...
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And the game is ready, guys. Gaara versus Jackie Chan. They did ban their Conceit Shamans. And this is elimination match, so whoever wins this goes through, whoever loses is eliminated from the tournament.
Yeah.
What do you think about those hands?
Well, it's a traditionally Zhu just has a good matchup against Tempo Mage because they build up a board earlier that's usually pretty resilient to the spells that Tempo Mage has. But I feel like the matchup's gotten a lot closer. I feel like mages put a lot more early game spells in their deck than they used to. They have more chance to get through the early game with a decent sized board. And a lot of mages, you have Flamestrike in their Tempo Mage decks now, and Jackie Chan is one of those players which can help you swing a game in the later turns. So I think it's gotten a lot closer.
Yeah, some people even have double Flamestrike, and also you have Yogg-Saron, so if you stall the game long enough, maybe Yogg-Saron can actually turn the tide.
Yeah.
Keep in mind, guys, these two players already played against each other in the first round of the tournament, of the group.
Yep.
And Jackie Chan in that matchup came out on top, and what do you think? Does that actually change the fact how they queue up the decks? Because I think we also saw the first this matchup, the Tempo Mage versus the Zhu, in the first time they played, right?
Yeah, and Jackie Chan won. Yeah.
I don't remember exactly anymore, but I think, yeah, both players basically going for the same strategy as last time, I think. No, there's no different bands.
Well, in the game, the match came down to game number five, and it was actually a really close game number five, so... I mean, why would they switch up their strategy? They both ban the same decks.
Yeah, but they didn't know before what decks they had, the enemy brought.
Oh, right? Yeah.
So maybe the strategy could have changed, I suppose. But yeah. I think there's like nothing different as far as I know.
And Jackie Chan, you can kind of guess. It's going to be Yogg.
It's definitely going to be a wacky matchup.
Yeah.
By Wacky Chan. I mean, he always is known for bringing those crazy builds. And so is Gaara, to be fair. Like, both these players, very creative deck builders and always bring something fresh to the table. I'm really always looking forward to see what they have in store.
And that's really the beauty of Hearthstone again, that you can still change the metagame a bit. You can still bring something interesting. Obviously, there are some lineups that are considered the best, but there is a surprise factor that can win you a match or two. And it actually is really important to get out of this group and then be able to advance in the tournament.
See, this is something interesting, the surprise factor. I was talking about it with other people as well today. It's actually really good for ladder, I think, having the surprise factor, just being one step ahead of the meta and like your opponent never knowing what you have. But for a tournament like this, where every match is streamed and everybody, like after your first match, everyone knows your whole deck, the surprise factor obviously wanes, so in that case, the deck has to be very solid overall, which usually those surprise tech builds are not.
Yeah, but the thing is, like, even if you bring this new deck, your opponent might not... Like, he knows you're playing this deck, but then he will have to practice exactly against this deck with his lineup. So there is still a chance that you kind of, like, you knowing all your matchups, you are in a better position.
Ooh. Well... Mirror Image again presents an interesting situation. Flamestrike is pretty bad on this board because you have to trade in one of your minions anyway. And then you still leave a 1-1. I guess you could try and hide your Flamestrike and hide your minions behind the Mirror Image to try and make room. Or you could face a Summoner and try and hide your minions behind the Mirror Image to make for a better Flamestrike next turn.
Well, I feel like the Flamestrike right now is as good as it gets, I think.
Yeah, with images as well. You protect your minions. What?
also when you see like the zoo only has one card in hand, it's unlikely he's going to be able to refill the board instantly, except if he has Forbidden Ritual.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's absolutely okay, especially because you have Faceless in your hand as a follow-up.
Yeah.
Nyman versus Powder is a 2-2. That's an elimination match as well at the very moment, I think. So the loser is going to eliminate from their group, and the winner is probably going to face Lothar, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, that's
correct. Correct.
And Hoi moved on from that group already, so yeah. with a 2-0 score.
Well, getting spell damage means that you can play it and play a 3-2 minion and kill the 5-cent with Fireball.
I think that's...
But then also, like, Faceless is great because...
Just more power, yeah. That's probably not what he wanted.
He didn't want to dance.
No. He was doing that so that the Doomguard wouldn't be able to get sort of a free trade-in and he could develop another minion before he was forced to use a spell to clear it off the board. But the Torn War is bad because it sort of gives the Doomguard a free trade when he would otherwise just fireball it next turn anyway.
Yeah.
So...
And also, like, Gar is definitely not happy of this power of roaming here, because if you'll be able to play the 1-5 and buff it this turn, that would be great. And passing. Ika, what do you think about passing this turn?
Well, I mean, what are you going to do with Darkshire Councilman? He's just going
to be eaten
by the Faceless Summoner. And, yeah, Gar is going to just take his time with this Councilman until he maybe draws a Forbidden Ritual, making him big immediately.
Yeah, like, even next turn... Ritual is great, but if you don't get Ritual, let's say you get like Juggler and some other minion, at least this means Councilman a 3-5.
Yeah.
And a really good situation for Jackie Chan overall here. You can Fireball if you want to deal with the 5-5. How much damage do you have? You have 8 damage here, plus... can you consider even going for face? Because this Doomguard is going to get blocked by the 0-2.
It's the same situation as last turn, yeah. I think you can just go for the
face.
Sorcerer.
Yeah, Sorcerer. And
yeah.
Okay, he's trading it anyway. But because like you have to consider how many cards Zoo actually has to deal with the 0-2 taunt.
Not many.
What would you have? Like maybe something from Peddler. But then like you have to have like a Stuntusk Boar and PO.
You could have Crazed Alk, but he already used it early on.
Yeah. Also, by fireballing to the face, you deny the Warlock life taps in the future, so it doesn't have as many possibilities to outvalue the Tempo Mage by life tapping a bunch. But yeah, this was a fine play. Keeping the board clear is obviously really good, and Jackie Chan takes the first game, which is surprising considering that Tempo Mage generally struggles against Zoo.
Yeah, I think that's a really good win for Jackie Chan to start the series. Especially because Tempo Mage might be good versus other decks that Gaara has also.
Well, that Flamestrike basically turned the game around for Jackie Chan completely.
All right, so game number 2, Gaara versus Jackie Chan. He stays with his Tempo Mage because this is last hero standing format. Gaara taking his super greedy Taunt Druid.
The Zoth Druid.
Yeah, the Zoth Druid.
It's amazing. If someone told me beforehand that the Zoth Druid is an actual deck, then I wouldn't have believed him. But Gaara trying to prove me wrong here. So we'll see how this one goes.
I mean, if it gets ramp, it's really good. And ramp is easier to come by nowadays because of Mire Keeper. And it still has like the whole spell package that normal druids have that make them be able to deal with early aggression pretty well. They have Living Runes, they have Wrath, they have Swipe. So, I mean, why not? When you can beat those sort of aggressive matchups with those early spells and still have a good matchup against control by being able to have the longevity that Nazoth provides. Seems like a good deck.
We got a really good hand for Jackie Chan, a good poker hand, the 2-pair.
Well, yeah, he has a start, but then Gaara kept Wrath and Swipe, so he got that removal going on for him. No turn 3, though, for Gaara, which is troublesome.
Yeah. Especially if you miss a turn and leave up a Cold Sorcerer. Because you know that if you leave up a Cold Sorcerer, they're going to have an answer to it going into the next turn. I mean, I guess you just have to hero power the Sorcerer and...
Maybe even, like, set up a Swipe.
Yeah, but I think, yeah, you definitely have to hit this.
I like it.
Telegraphs a weak hand from Gaara that where, like, Jackie Chan might think of two things right now. Either that Gaara is setting up for a Swipe, or that Gaara just has a very weak hand and is forced to hero power on the following turn.
Yeah.
But yeah, Jackie Chan is gladly taking that potential second hero power here. I mean, if the Cold Sorcerer is able to deal 9 damage, that's already amazing.
Yeah. What do you guys think about, instead of going for the 2-3 taunt, going for Mire Keeper, getting yourself a crystal, then next turn you'll have 6 mana, so you can play Kern, maybe, possibly. You want to kind of go for the 5-6 taunt?
And I think he has a good curve no matter if he ramps or not. And he wants something to stick around going into the next turn. So either this Infested Tauren eats up resources and forces Jackie Chan to have a weaker turn than he otherwise would have if he had just played Mire Keeper, or he has to trade it in and just leave something, just a smaller thing on the board.
Yeah, it makes sense. And he still has the 5 drop anyway.
Yeah.
So now the question is, what does he do about this 2-2 that's left over from the Death Rattle? He has the option, of course, of killing it with a second Arcane Blast just to preserve his 3-1.
Yeah.
Forcing Gaara to take action, maybe with a hero power once again.
Well, killing it makes sense. Like, you still deal face damage and you have a 3-1 on board. So if you have, if there's like Druid of the Claw that you kind of expect, then you still have a free damage that you can deal to it. And if there is no Druid of the Claw, as Eagle mentioned, you have to shapeshift, so you only have 3 mana available for your
Yeah. play.
So from Gaara's perspective, just facing this 3-1, if you go, like, you've seen double Arcane Blast, but there's a couple of cards that can deal with this 5-6. If there's a Fireball, you just lose it and then get another free damage to face.
Also, like always, the Arcane Missiles and the Frost Bolts and whatever.
Yeah.
So much potential damage sources.
But Jackie Chan's hand is kind of cluttered with cards that he doesn't really want in this matchup.
Yeah, he got a very awkward hand early on. I mean, it was... It's not a good thing to have like 2 pairs and the opening hand usually.
Especially Flame Strike.
Yeah, especially Flame Strike.
In this matchup, it's really not going to hit much. So he just has to trade it in, and that just gives Gaara the green light to start throwing down these big drops.
I think this is a good position for Gaara overall, because Jackie Chan doesn't want to trade minions, and he just needs to kill Gaara before Gaara stabilizes. And on Gaara's side, he has the taunt, he has this shield maw, so he will be able to start like developing a board and trying to stabilize from this turn.
Yeah. Well, what is that, Spawn of Nazoth? Is that what that's called?
Yeah, Spawn of Nazoth.
Gives your minions +1/+1?
+1/+1 when it dies, yeah.
Yeah.
Correct.
So, a little bit annoying.
I think if there is reason not to go for Shilmo here, so what we can do, for example, is we can swipe and a Wrath to clear this board and attack as well with Karen. Which means like we still have a good minion on board and the board is cleared on the other side, which is the card. Like if we go for just Chilmo, this means like we lose Chilmo to the 6/6 after. Like you have to attack into the Spawn of Nazoth. So Chilmo doesn't look that good. Maybe you can consider Sylvanas as well, but then you take 6 damage to face, which means like you help Mage with their goal, which is just kill you before you stabilize.
Yeah.
So I think killing those minions should be the priority. And he can still play Mire Keeper. Yeah, that's a really nice play. Not only clearing the board, but also developing a board of his own.
Yeah. I think the cycle is pretty big deal there. But this will open up a Flame Strike for Jackie Chan. It's going to make it possible. I mean, it's still going to leave a 4-1 on the board, but what else are you going to do?
He can also just throw away this Flames. I mean, the Flame Strike in general is not as good in this matchup, considering the beefiness of the minions in Gaara's deck.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this is as good as it gets with the Flame Strike. And even if there was a potential better scenario for it, he still has a second Flame Strike.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was looking if there is any play with Flame Waker and Apprentice, but there is only one spell you can cast with them, even though the images would be nice, and Druid just use a couple of removal cards. You can do it later. So for Gaara, this is a good spot overall. He's still at 21. He has a minion on board. He's seen one Flame Strike. He can just continue developing. He's taking initiative, which is super important in this matchup.
If you have initiative against a Temple Mage, unless they're like pooling cards to try and go for a big Flame Waker, you're almost always going to win.
Yeah. Almost always because there's Yogg-Saron as well.
Yeah, almost always because there's Yogg-Saron, and also almost always because sometimes they just did so much damage early that they're just going to top deck two fireballs and kill you. But yeah, Yogg-Saron is always in the back of your mind.
Are some tempo mages, they still play Conjurer? Or some
builds?
No, they just everybody cut Conjurer now? I've seen Conjurer in the ladder from time to time.
Yeah, sometimes Conjurer's in there. Just too, I don't know, it feels too slow sometimes.
It's a different build. Like you have the slower build with Kabbalist Tome and Conjurer, but like this is the deck that Jackie Chan is playing right now. The thing that RDU played at DreamHack Summer is the most popular.
Yeah, Conjurer is in a weird spot. Ooh. Because it's bad against aggro since it dies to pretty much everything. And it's bad against, I mean, it's not as good as Kabbalist Tome against control.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's kind of in a weird spot, unfortunately, right now.
Really depends like what you want to target with your tempo mage to begin with.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dread Scale.
That's actually a really good pickup because that means the 4-1 Bane Bloodhoof is going to die. So Dread Scale ends up being MVP right there.
Who would have died to the hero power anyway? But yeah.
Well, it means he can put more damage onto the Ancient of War.
True.
Probably not that. It might be a big deal.
Every damage matters.
Yeah.
Well, the problem with Dread Scale is actually you put the faceless in the swipe range now. So you can swipe in hero power. Want to. But you probably don't want to do it.
And he's not developing anything.
Yeah, you're left. If you swipe here, you're left with a whole bunch of clunky cards. And usually this would call for an Emperor just to get more convenient turns later on with all those clunky cards in your hand.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, because then you can fit in Swipe plus it being dropped next turn.
Yeah, I like Emperor. But then what do you kill the 5-8? I guess just kill the 4-2. Oh, Sylvanas.
Ooh, okay.
So Sylvanas is awkward in a way for Mage, because he still like it denies Flame Strike a bit. And you will need to trade with both minions into the 5-8 and then, I guess, Fireball Sylvanas if you have it. And if you don't have damage, like mostly Tempo Mage would like to develop some kind of board before he starts throwing spells. So you want to play Sorceress and Flame Waker. So this means like you will need to spend your spells on Sylvanas before you can play your cards.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Sylvanas also can be ignored, considering that Jackie Chan has the mirror image.
Well, you can Flame Strike here as well with Ping.
Yeah.
Well, just trade your minions into the taunt and then Flame Strike Ping to deal with Sylvanas. That's
yeah, true. But if he goes for a Flame Strike, then he gives Garo the initiative with the board presence again.
Yeah, he can so cross
bolt. There's a problem, right? So
trade Ping.
Basically,
without using Flame Strike.
Basically, okay, he chooses to go for the middle ground here, still killing off both minions, but at least he has a minion to follow this up.
Yeah, that's much better.
And he still has Yogg.
Yep.
So anything's possible.
It's not time for Yogg yet, but Yogg can be useful. And Garra has such an honest hand. Now less honest with Raven Idol, but just big minions. So these are with Raven Idol. See what you get. If you get like Feral Rage, you can deal with the 4/4, play Thorsen.
I personally like Thorsen to swipe here.
It's not bad.
Spell damage obviously is always scary, even though Arcane Blasts are gone, but there's still plenty of other spells potentially. So yeah, Emperor, it's just the most solid play mana-wise as well.
Yeah, it's fine. Well,
and makes those 7 drops cheaper, which is very important.
It's not even fine, it's probably the best. But and like even if he gets Feral Rage, I would probably prefer using Feral Rage. Oh, yeah, there's the Feral Rage I was talking about. In this matchup, I like using Armor Up with Feral Rage, just getting extra 8 armor, which means it's harder for the mage to kill me.
But is that worth not killing a Azure Drake? I don't think so.
This is such a weird line. I don't know what Garo's really expecting out of this Raven Idol.
Feral Rage. that was something I was expecting.
But I suppose he would have played the 7 drop instead of Emperor if he got like something expensive.
Yeah.
And he just chose to ignore the Azure Drake, which can backfire sometimes.
Well, you can go Sorcerer's Apprentice into Arcane Intellect and still have enough mana for Yeah, Flame Waker, Fireball. Depending on what you get. Gives us no point in not playing the Flame Waker first also. And then I guess there's no point in not Fireballing first also, if that's what you're going to do. Get all those Flame Juggles to the face.
Yep, a lot of damage to Gaara's face right there.
Might as well. He's still got one Fireball in the deck, right?
And,
he's only
and
used
actually,
one.
This swipe all of a sudden is not as amazing because it doesn't clear the entire board.
It's good enough.
It's only able to deal with one minion.
It's good enough, though, dealing with the Flame Waker. But the Gaara dropping down to 12.
I mean, Yogg is... It's getting juicier.
Oh, yeah, the Yogg is going to be a big factor soon enough.
I hope like Jackie-chan is counting spells, because the more spells you get, the worse Yogg becomes. Like, you kind of want to be there between 10 and 14. And if you get to like 20 plus...
So, Grimsh, have you been keeping count?
I haven't been counting spells, unfortunately. But I believe Jackie-chan did. I hope he did.
Yeah, that's what you should do when you play Yogg generally.
All right, so quickly, TJ, let's review this game. How many spells have you seen?
Well, there were
nine.
Two Arcane Blasts.
Yeah, Arcane Blast in the beginning.
One Arcane Missiles, two Mirror Image, one Frostbolt, one Flame Strike, one Arcane Intellect.
One Fireball.
It's nine, ten.
So let's say around 12 spells.
Wow, we got to 12 real quick. Let's look at how many cards are left. Nine. Oh, wow. Okay.
Makes sense, right? There's like still...
Yeah.
I think like Yogg overall is getting to the sweet spot.
I think the more spells that you cast, the better Yogg gets, because the more fun it gets.
Yeah, I feel like Jackie Chan is one of those guys who really want to maximize their Yogg.
Yeah.
As many spells as possible.
Well, he might not need to play Yogg this game if Ragnar is doing this stuff.
Yeah, he's just going to win.
Winning without Yogg is boring. Come on, guys. We have
what?
To see Yogg.
No, it's awesome. Winning is awesome overall. So do you nourish for mulch?
Well, you have to, right?
If you play a 6-6...
It just dies.
In theory, and if you get like if it does not die, you still get like 8 damage to face, which is not good.
Yeah.
You have to nourish, I believe.
But does he have mulch in his deck? Is the thing. I don't know if we saw one earlier.
And sometimes in like Ram Druids, you don't play mulch. I don't know exactly what Gaara's playing, but I've been playing a list from Valencia, the Ram Druid as well, and there was no mulch in the list.
Well, that sort of tells us, by playing Chomal, he tells us that he doesn't really have hard removal in his deck.
Yeah.
Or he just tells us that he has 14 cards left. He doesn't think that hard removal is going to be in the next three. But...
Yeah, Gaara definitely in a very bad spot right now, thanks to this Ragnaros.
Well, so there is a Flame Strike. You can Flame Strike and trade. And then you have still 3 mana left, so you can Arcane Missiles and Hero Power for 4, which means your opponent will be at 2 left after the hit.
So 2 off. You can Flame Strike and Arcane Missiles, and if you hit that Arcane Missiles, is that it?
That should be it, I
think. Clearly Yogg's around was lethal as well, right?
And that will be plus 4 damage, which
not
means
quite.
1 off. Ah, God.
Should have played Yogg, would have been lethal. Guaranteed.
Yeah.
But for whom?
Yeah.
Yeah. Would have been lethal.
And 4, it does not save you. This time Gaara is actually opting for the nourish. Nope. He dies. And Jackie-chan takes game number 2. There was no way.
Yeah, technically, if he played the druid and armored up, he would have been alive. Technically.
Yeah, if he does not play nourish. Yes.
Yeah, if
like
he doesn't
no
play
nourish.
Is,
yeah.
Just, yeah.
All right, I think Gaara's in a lot of trouble because that druid was what was winning him games when these guys played earlier on in the group. The finals came down to druid versus druid because now all Gaara has left is warrior. He has to sweep with warrior.
What is the warrior that he's playing?
Dragon warrior.
Just a standard tempo dragon warrior.
I believe so.
Probably with Deathwing because it's Gaara. And if
yeah.
you can have Deathwing.
No, he has doesn't he have Onyxia?
Onyxia is playable as well in the deck. So you either play Onyxia or Deathwing.
Yeah, I think he has a Nyxia, actually.
Both are reasonable, for sure.
Yeah, but that means Jackie Chan has to win, beat this warrior with either Druid, Mage, or Paladin, and a couple of his matchups are pretty good.
What do you think of Inner Rage that Gaara just mulliganed away? in the Dragon Warrior in
you
general.
You mean like overall?
Yeah,
general.
Like,
okay.
Do you like it? Do you not like it?
Honestly, I'm not playing it myself. I prefer a version without Inner Rage, but I've seen Inner Rage versions being successful as well. It gives you some more options. So like Inner Rage can be a removal card with Azure Drake to like deal to damage. It can be removal early on when you need tempo, so like you can fight for tempo a bit better. And also obviously like buffing your minion and just jamming into another minion.
Yeah,
so
the surprise Grom finish as well.
Yeah, yeah, it's not bad. Like even like with Finley, if you have the Inner Rage, you have like a free two.
But the card is very situational. At least it was, I tried it out. It never was really good for me, so
yeah, me too.
I prefer not playing it.
I don't like it myself as well. But I can see a reason to play it in your deck.
So yeah, Finley gets arguably the best hero power in the game with the life tap.
Yeah, arguably the best, but is it the best in this situation? Because you just lost armor up, which means Freeze Mage, Tempo Mage. If he starts dealing damage, if he gets low enough, you'll not have any ability to heal. This deck does not run Armor Smith or Life Gain.
But sometimes you don't need Life Gain because you're going to win the race.
Yeah.
Yeah. Most likely.
Gaara is basically taking the Zoo approach once more, trying to beat the first Zoo deck failed, so now Gaara is trying to beat Jackie Chan's Tempo Mage with the second Zoo deck.
Emulating the Zoo experience.
Yeah.
Jackie Chan's trying to decide what to do. It's really annoying because you don't really want to Frostbolt a Sir Finley Murgleton because it's just not that threatening. One power is not really that much.
And if you play it, if there is Ghoul, Ravage and Ghoul, you know there is a coin as well. So you just lose your free two.
Or Blood Digger or Fiery War Axe. There's so many things that, that punish
stuff.
It. And Sorcerer's Apprentice is not like a two drop that it's just one that you want to play to curve out. It's definitely one that has a lot of value as the game goes on.
But there is some reasoning to play the free two anyway, because if there is an Alexstrasza champion and you play the free two, then you had like a good way to interact with it and nothing else. Like, so basically, if Gaara would be forced to play Alexstrasza champion, you at least have like a good trade there.
Yeah. I like Fairy Dragon better here. Yeah. It's one of the best cards against Temple Mage.
Yeah. Can't go to with Arcane Blast.
Or spells. Any spell or hero power. So Flame Strike is okay, but it misses a lot of things in this match. By the time it's played, there's usually the four health minions are not present anymore. It's usually like Twilight Guardians, Draconid Crusher.
Yeah, so and at this point, like drawing Flame Strike is really terrible. Like you definitely want to draw something you'll be able to play on 4, 5, 6.
Yeah.
This has got to be this got to feel bad for Jackie Chan right there. Frostboding a 1-3, the most useless minion in Gaara's deck, pretty much, when it comes to stat. There's so many minions that Frostbolt is being used better on. Alexstrasza Champion, Ravaging Ghoul, Frothing Berserker, any type of those minions,
yeah.
But nope.
Now we have a fancy play that's super weak versus Arcane Missile, so you probably don't go for it. Not against this deck, because we can, like, Blatsu Ikor the 3-2 and then play Ravaging Ghoul, but I don't like it myself. I think
that might be the best play, to be honest.
No, I think it's weak against the Tempo Mage. I would probably just go Alexstrasza's Champion, life tap, then Champion. Use the coin as well.
And what do you trade in that case? Do you trade in the Champion or do you
trade
in the Fairy Dragon?
I think I trade Champion.
I would also. I would just play Blatsu Ikor and Alexstrasza's Champion as well. Get a big board presence. And then you can just kill off the Sorcerer's Apprentice with a Fairy Dragon, in my opinion. Because you saw the Frostbolt go out now, so like a clear way of killing the Alexstrasza's Champion is gone. And then you would rather have more health on the minion in case there's Arcane Missiles and Flame Waker.
There can be a Blast as well, but hey, he's going for the big play with Ghoul. Like, this is creating the biggest board, but It's ballsy. It's so weak to Arcane Missiles and a possible like even Flame Waker with something.
Yeah. Also, he just lost both enablers for his execute, which could be a important thing, you know.
Well, you normally expect on this turn like Water Elemental. So like Gaara making this play says, you have a Water Elemental, you're going to play it, and then I can easily deal with it with my 2-1 and execute and just continue going face. But.
Yep.
Yeah, Flame Waker with like Arcane Missiles or Flame Waker with even like Mirror Entity images.
Wow.
So oh, yeah.
Wow.
There we go.
That feels good, right?
Feels good, man.
12 damage on turn 4.
Those are some cheap Cochrane Elites right there.
Yeah,
and
real cheap.
Crusher is already a 9-9 on turn 6.
Yeah, if he gets to turn six.
Yeah, Gaara just steamrolling Jackie Chan right now, and Jackie Chan definitely in a very precarious spot. Might be forced to fireball one of those champions.
Yeah, because if he doesn't, then there's 12 damage on the board. All Gaara needs is a Fiery War Axe to finish the game. And he has two draws to do it with the tap, and you haven't seen one yet, so Onyxia doesn't do it.
Yeah, but still.
Yeah.
I think you can safely tap here first, actually.
Inner Rage will do it as well. Azuradrake won't. But you still just hit him in the face.
Yeah. There's just no way for the Temple Mage to recover from this, but hand from Jackie Chan was really bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, very clunky indeed. But this is how his deck looks like. He plays double Faceless Summoner, double Flame Strike, Ragnaros as well.
It's very slow. It's very greedy.
It can be very. It can struggle a lot in the early game.
So he could technically survive here by fireballing and trading off the Azuradrake into one of these. But yeah, that is going to do it. Fiery War Axe will be enough.
All right, so there is a reason people ban Warrior in this format as well. And Gaara is taking the first game to himself.
Well, when you get an opening hand like that, it's sometimes hard to lose. And Jackie Chan had a bad opening with just a lot of his heavy drops. He had, like we talked about, the Flame Strike, the Faceless Summoner, all in the early hand. So I don't think he's too upset about that. Still got Druid and Paladin, the Nazoth Paladin, awaiting. So which one of these is better against Dragon Warrior? Probably Nazoth Paladin.
I would like to check Druid, I think.
Really? Okay.
All right, but like I need to think about Nazoth Paladin because Nazoth Paladin is not that popular at the moment. So Nazoth Paladin has a lot of removal, it has heals. I'm not sure though. Like if Jackie's strategy is not to ban Warrior, he is prepared to fight Warriors.
Yeah.
But I like matchup Druid versus Warrior from Druid's perspective.
Okay.
And the reason is because you can cheat with Innervates. You have Ram.
You can cheat?
You can cheat, yeah. You can actually cheat with Innervates. You never play Druid? It's legal cheating.
It does feel like cheating, that's true.
There's their Inner Rage. But yeah, like sometimes you have those openings where Warrior just can't do anything. And even if you have normal openings when Warrior can do things, you go head to head and then you just have better value cards. You have answers for their big stuff as well.
Yeah. All right, well, that's a pretty good opening hand for Jackie Chan. Has Ramp, has Violet Teacher, has Coin. Gaara has removal, but no minions at the moment to follow up with that removal.
This is a terrible hand for Gaara.
That's such a good Raven Idol. So Innervate, Feral Rage, and Wild Growth.
Yeah.
Normally when you Raven Idol turn one, you're looking for either Wild Growth or Innervate. I think Innervate here is a keep.
Yeah, you guys can't see it, but like Nimsh said, Wild Growth, Feral Rage, Innervate. I mean, it's a snap call on Innervate, right?
You can think about others as well, because Feral Rage can be really useful as a removal card, but then you have a hand that really works with that Innervate. Mm-hmm. And in tournaments, normally snap calls are a bad decision.
Yeah. Man. Oh my god.
Well, except the Vandral as well.
Yeah.
Do you think we will ever see Wisps of the Old Gods for the Wisps and the Big Wisps?
I mean, even after Vandral surviving? Okay, so Gaara has a really bad hand, but the only thing he actually has is a removal at the moment. So Vandral might have trouble surviving.
Yeah.
No dragon.
Yeah.
That Crocolisk doesn't look that good.
It's a fancy looking river croc. That's what that is. A beckoner of evil.
Yeah, and this, I mean, this Alexstrasza champion coming down as a 2-3 also gives Jackie Chan a lot of information about Gaara's hand. So many cards that Jackie Chan does not have to play around anymore right
no
now.
No dragons, at least. All right, so for Jackie Chan, let's see, what is the dream turn? Do you go for your turn right now? Just Mire Keeper, get more mana?
Yeah, just keep ramping up. And another Fire War Axe doesn't help very much.
Like, overall, what would you probably like to do on turn six, go ham with Violet Teacher and things? Like, even go, like, Violet Teacher, Innervate, Fandral, and maybe you will pick up something else as well. And then turn seven, go Wisps. And if one of those minions survives, like, if there is no Ravaging Ghoul with, like, double Execute, you might end up in a really good spot.
With this kind of turn that Garo has right now, do you think Slam would be a viable option? Because on the following turns, he really will need some good stuff to just follow up his turns, follow up this weak turn, get a good turn 5 play, get a good turn 6 play. Slam might have enabled that.
Yeah, I think I would slam to draw a card because this hand is terrible and it really needs... Like, the best card you can play on turn 5 is Corruptor. But to play Corruptor and have an effect, you will need also like a dragon. So you want to draw more, basically.
He really wants to go for a big combo.
Oh!
He's holding on to Violet Teacher.
Double Wisps of the Old Gods. That is a Jackie Chan classic right there.
Yeah. Jackie Chan was the original creator of this deck with Wisps and Soul of the Forest. So there is the Corruptor I was talking about, but no dragon. If the dragon is the next card, by the way, the slam to draw a card was better. Yeah. Also, like, if you slam to draw a card, you can still Blood to Ichor your own 2/3 to have like to have more board presence.
True.
Well, Wild Growth doesn't. Well, maybe it'll help. Gets him close to a big combo, but eventually he's gonna have to play something.
Imagine it might actually happen. Fandral into Innervate Coin Wisps.
Yeah, next turn. Next turn, it definitely happens. So, like, how do you set up for that?
You try and get him to blow removal right now.
So maybe you go for Violet Teacher with...
maybe just Wisps?
Yeah, just Wisps. Wisps should be fine as well. And see, like, hey, do you have a Ghoul?
Yeah. I don't think Ghoul really matters if he's going for Fandral. Gonna make Coin Wisps.
Can't he actually go for Fandral right now? He has how much mana? 10. Okay, he has 10 mana, so not enough.
Maybe Violet Teacher Wild Growth?
Yeah, Violet Teacher Wild Growth seems like a good option. Might preserve the coin if he really needs it later on.
I kind of like Wisps, just Wisps better, though. It's a lot weaker to Ravaging Ghoul. Oh, maybe he is worried about Ravaging Ghoul because Gar did keep a few cards, and he knows that one of those cards isn't a dragon.
Yeah, there's never been a good spot for the Ravaging Ghoul yet, so Jackie Chan is definitely cautious about that.
Yeah.
And obviously Gar knows Jackie Chan's deck as well.
Yeah. I mean, is Jackie Chan even going to have enough time? There's going to be a lot of damage being pushed.
Yeah, there's some damage, but then like you create such a big board. That's...
Yeah, but if he creates a big board, does he just die the following turn?
So this turn, how much damage do you take? You
it's
take
probably
going to
Warax
damage.
And...
I think you're still good. So it's 9 this turn to face, which means you are at, what, like 15? Yeah. So 15 and a... Oh, it's even less now, so you're at 17. So you're good. So this is 6.
It's 14.
Yeah.
All right, is it time?
It's time.
Yeah, Jackie, go for it.
Fun with Fandral.
Yeah, Fandral bringing fun to Druid. Yes, you Fandral first. You don't innervate coin first. You Fandral first. Then you innervate coin.
You don't even need coin.
Oh, you didn't even need coin,
yeah,
right.
You
Wild Growth last turn.
So cool.
Here we go.
You don't have a choice.
All right, so Gaara has some outs here. Cork on Elite would be a cork.
Oh,
there it is.
Whoa.
That's it. Wow.
It's 18
that's
damage.
Enough. Yep.
So a cute play by Jackie Chan, but TJ, you're right.
Just didn't have enough time. And that's going to be Gaara tying up the series. And Jackie Chan puts it in his hands. That would have been crazy, too, because the thing is, he would have been able to Wisps the Old Gods next turn again.
Yeah.
Give everything +2. Even if things were traded off the board, he probably would have had enough damage to close out the game. But in the end, we're going to another game 5.
And now you have to think about this matchup as well. The Zoth Paladin versus Dragon. Dragon can win it being aggressive. And sometimes, like, this Zoth Paladin will have to really get good answers to everything.
Yes.
Like a Doomsayer early, then just clearing the board. But Dragon Warrior is really good at just going for face.
Yeah, the Zoth Paladin generally can handle aggressive decks pretty well. However, the more chargers the aggressive deck has, the harder it gets for the Zoth Paladin because it cannot interact with charge, really. Like, and the only way to interact with charge is taunt, and the Zoth Paladin doesn't have a lot of taunters.
And Dragon Warrior is not a traditional aggro deck. I mean, it's sort of like a mid-range deck.
Yeah.
With more aggressive tools. Like, it has the option to play more aggressively. Like, we saw Chalky in his match that he lost earlier. He saw his hand and he said, you know what, I have to start playing really aggressively and started to hit bass more. But, you know, this deck can play more of a slow style if the other deck gives it the chance to be slower.
Yeah, but I think, like, versus Nazoth Paladin, you still want to be as aggressive.
You still want to be aggressive, yeah.
Like, you play the mid-range game and, like, hey, I play my Crusher. And he's like, oh, cool, I have my Alder ready for your Crusher.
Yeah.
Let's play some mid-range games. No dragons.
Yeah.
Not yet.
Yeah, but still, like, you would love to have a dragon overall.
So I think you just equip Borax. Well, I see the Fruit of Ooze, but we saw much of Jackie Chan's deck earlier, and we didn't see an Ooze, so... Actually, nobody really has Ooze.
Yeah, probably. And Jackie Chan is also banning rogues, so...
Yeah.
But still, Jackie Chan's... Like, we're talking this with Paladin, but Jackie Chan's list is a bit awkward again. Like, he's playing Elise to be able to win versus control decks.
Yeah.
And he has this Coliseum card. Enter the Coliseum.
Yeah.
Or is it Coliseum? How do you say that?
Coliseum. Yeah. It's like a... I was talking about it earlier. It's like a better brawl in a lot of situations. Against aggressive decks. Because a lot of times, your biggest minion is better than their biggest minion.
If there's a bunch of one attack minions, is it just random?
I imagine so. No, all the one health minions live.
It's hard
to
say.
No, I mean, the minion that survives is determined by random.
It's just turn. Yeah. We talked about it earlier, and it might be like first played, but if it's like a tentacles effect or like Anixia, I'm not sure. Hmm. I mean, it doesn't really matter. It's 1-1 at the end of the day. Maybe one of those 1-1s has like a buff on it, like Blessing of Wisdom, or what other buffs don't have any stat effects? Powered Shield.
By the way, meanwhile, Jackie Chan is in trouble. And the fact that it was this Fire War Axe to deal with the 1-1. Like, normally, Rallying Blade is great when you have 1-1 because you deal with most of the stuff, dealing 4 damage.
Yeah.
But with the loss of the 1-1, you just can't really do anything with this Frothing.
Yeah, he's probably going to have to use Pyro Quality pretty early.
Yeah, now Gaara actually has this Charger available to him. But not much more.
We'll probably see it anyway.
Yeah, 6 to face, armor up.
I mean, the Alexstrasza champion on the current board state alone represents 6 damage. 3 right now and 3 after Jackie Chan attacks into it.
Yeah.
So 6 damage for 2 mana, not too shabby.
Yeah, not bad. Now we have Keeper as a possibility to just reduce Frothing to a 3-3 kill with the weapon, and then you 3-4 contest a 3-3 on board. Is there anything better? He has 2 Keepers, so I kind of like it the most, probably. Like, Keeper is also a great removal card for the big creatures, like a Crusher, Ragnaros. But he has so much removal in the deck that I think just being able to remove the Frothing right now and being able to have a 3-4 left is pretty good.
Yeah, for sure. And you don't really want to use Pyro Equality yet because, I don't know, I feel like that's a misuse of resources.
Oh, I think you can actually throw one of those away because you have the second equality. You will draw an enabler for it at some point anyway.
Yeah, but
and
how quickly?
If you really want to deal with big minions, you will have those Keeper of all demands already. So I think it's fine to just go for it.
Do I remember correctly, guys, that the previous versions of Nazoth Paladins, like, they run maybe 1 Keeper and then they turn to 0 Keepers at some point?
Well, Jackie's version is a lot different. It's not very heavy on the... Like, I think it runs 1 lay on hands. And, oh, what other heavy drop did it exclude? Justicar, True Heart?
No True Heart, okay.
Less card draw in the early game.
Well, right now we can talk about like the new Nazoth breed, because Nazoth Paladin was just dead in the metagame for the last like couple of weeks.
Yeah, except for in some rare last Hero Standing tournaments. Last Hero Standing is really the only place where it's actually decent because it can be used as a counter matchup.
Yeah, also now Hunter is less and less popular, so you can actually play it.
I never understood the Hunter fad to begin with.
Okay.
I don't know.
Hunter's pretty strong. Call of the Wild is pretty strong.
Call of the Wild is great, but the rest of Hunter is not great.
That's true.
That's why people play Doomsayers in the early game.
Yeah.
Hunter decks.
It's like Hunters were good because there was a couple people playing control decks and they realized that Stampeding Coda was really good against, and Call of the Wild was really good against Tempo Warrior. But then every player realized that Dragon Warrior is just a better version of Tempo Warrior, and all of a sudden hunters couldn't win games anymore.
Correct.
But a hunter is actually a good deck to deal with Dragon Warrior.
Not really. I mean, all the weaknesses that it had, that Temple Warrior had to the hunter, it were sort of fixed with the Dragon Warrior. They couldn't quick shot the minion, 2-health minion anymore because it's a fairy dragon now. They have a better early game to contest things. That sort of mid game drop that they had with Bloodhoof Brave is a lot better with Twilight Guardian because it doesn't get killed by Stampede Kodo.
Yeah, but now like Hunter changes as well, and you play Deadly Shots then. So they play like a 6-drop. You have a Deadly Shot. You can't really deal with high main, and then
yeah.
You just trade minions into the Call of the Wild.
All right, Jackie Chan decides now is the time for the clear, finally using up that Pyromancer quality. What do you think about equality Pyromancer coin loot order? Just having two minions on the board after the clear. Sure, they're vulnerable to Ravaging Ghoul, but okay, there it is.
Yeah.
good read by Jackie Chan.
I think coin is still valuable. Like, having a 2-1 doesn't matter that much. You want to have the coin for the future turns.
You draw one of your A-drops in the next three turns, or the next two turns. You really want to have that, so. And it's actually getting more and more likely. He has Tyrion in both rags that he could draw.
And Lay on Hands, you've mentioned as well.
Lay on Hands. It's not as important, but it could be important. So being able to hold on to the coin and have the opportunity to play an 8-drop if you draw it is really important.
That Forbidden Healing is also a very huge draw. It will pretty much ensure that Gaara's Draconid Crushers will never be 9-9.
Yeah.
Bad situation for Gaara because you do have Execute, but you don't want to execute a 3-5. So I guess you start with the slam of the 3-5 and see what happens. But the rest of the cards you have in your hand did not work this turn. Bloodacre.
It might not be too bad to play Execute because what you just want as empty of a board as possible going into turn 8, right?
Well, in a way, but then on turn 8 you have those bombs and you need to have executes for them.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. So you just leave this here, but then you at least he has on the board, the Ravage Ghoul gets traded into.
You may actually like Bloodacre execute because you really you have a really good 8-drop next turn. So you try to like stay on tempo.
No, you definitely keep the Bloodacre
for Grom?
Either for the execute or for the Grom. This Elise is kind of irrelevant. It should just trade with a ghoul, pretty much.
It's a really tough situation.
Well, the weapon's going to trade with the ghoul, so...
Oh, he decides to go for the execute. So Gaara's game plan here is turn 8 rag, and then turn 9 Grom Bloodacre.
Grom and hope there is no heal.
Yeah,
that's pretty much the game plan. I mean, the Paladin is at 18. Just got to hope he doesn't have the heal. There's plenty of damage right now. Like 8 from the rag, 10 from the Grom. That's 18.
Yeah. So, it's probably just going to hit Hero Power and then Forbidden Rich or Forbidden Healing. You only heal for 10, so you go up to 25, but if you're expecting Rag on 8, you want to try and give it some fodder.
Yeah, just the one that can soak 8 damage.
Yeah, because he used an execute on a 3-2, so what's his plan on turn 8? He also passed the previous turn.
Which means he basically has the most expensive minions in the hand.
So, I think maybe just attacking, hero powering, and Forbidden Ritual. You don't heal for full, but you give it a better chance that Rag doesn't hit your face.
You can still expect from Jackie Chan's perspective. Obviously, like you have to think about Grom Ragnaros, but if Gaara's doing nothing, maybe there's a second execute that he still has in the hand that didn't have an activator before. Maybe there's an Ixia. That's also a big card you can keep on those turns.
I'm just going to go for the full 14. And 8 of that 14's going away.
Big Daddy Raggy coming down on the board.
And now Jackie would love to get a weapon. Yes, that's not a weapon. So how do you deal with this Ragnaros? There is equality consecration, but it seems so wasteful. So maybe just build up a board of your own.
It's a tricky situation for sure, but this is like the only big minion that you cannot deal with by using Keeper. So might as well go Equality Consecration, because any other big minion that comes after that gets dealt with by Keeper.
No, yeah. Well, but then like you think Onyxia on turn 9, and you know Onyxia is in the deck, so...
Oh yeah, I forgot about
you can't really go for Consecration. Yeah. So I think like Keeper, Hero Power... With six
well, mana. Against Onyxia you have the Enter the Colosseum.
So you Enter the Colosseum and Keeper of Ulduin.
Yep.
Yeah, and you have the coin. All right, makes sense if you go for that. Can you draw cards this turn?
No. Quality Consecrate leaves him with 2 mana. Even with coin, Solemn Vigil would still be 4. So...
I think I like Keeper Hero Power the most, because then Ragnaros has a chance to deal with one of the small minions, and if you expect something big next turn, you get more value from Equality Consecration.
Well, this is not what I expected.
This is a reasonable play too, honestly. But it is reasonable because like Ragnaros, it's unlikely that Gaara will be able to deal with both those minions, and I mean not unlikely, but it can happen that he's not able to deal with both those minions, and then one of those minions can tank a Rag shot.
Yeah,
like Jackie Chan just wants to commit, just wants Gaara to commit more to the board, so the Equality Consecration clear will have a bigger effect.
Yeah, exactly. And from Gaara's perspective, Ragnaros is still in game, which is cool, but you want to deal with the 3-4 maybe, so that there is no way to deal with the Rag. So there's a couple of options. Like you can Blood to Ichor the 3-4 and go Corruptor, but then as Ico mentioned, you want to have Blood to Ichor for Grommash. But you can also like Grommash into the 3-4 and maybe Blood to Ichor the 1-1, then Ragnaros goes face for 8 and you have a 10 something Grommash on board as well.
Yeah, I kind of like that play. I mean, obviously it gets punished in a big way by Equality Consecration, but I feel like Gaara might feel like, yeah, if he had the Equality Consecration, you would have played it maybe on the Rag, just like I suggested. But yeah, in this case, it all worked out perfectly for Jackie Chan. Now he's able to clear both those huge minions.
Yeah, now he also has the heal.
And gets the heal as well. Oh my god, this is huge.
And he can play Solemn Vigil.
Yeah. A pretty decent turn for the Paladin player here.
Yeah.
Gaara still has some follow-up. He has Corruptor next turn, but he's slowly running out of steam. Onyxia might be his best chance to be back on board.
Yeah. Well, Onyxia is going to do a lot of work, and a 9-9 Draconid Crusher could also do a lot of work.
Ooh, Ragnaros, the Light Lord, as well. So much healing in Jackie Chan's hand.
I think you can't really play Crusher here. There is a risk of Aldor, so right now with Frodding, you definitely go Corruptor face. Oh, is he going for Crusher even?
Of course, he's going for Crusher.
I don't think you can play around Peacekeeper. Like at this point, you are going to lose if you play slowly.
Exactly. I mean, he's at 13. You have a 9-9 on the board. He's got to have the solution, or else he's just dead.
Yeah.
I just don't like the idea of not having dragons in hand at this point. But I guess you still have a couple of dragons in your deck, and if the 9-9 is unanswered, yeah, your guys are right.
He has a lot of dragons in his deck still. He's got one Azure Drake, he's got Onyxia, he's got both Fairy Dragons, he's got a Twilight Guardian. So almost probably a little bit more than a third of his deck are dragons, maybe even more. Second Dragon did Crusher as well. So how many cards does he have left?
16 cards left in Gaara's deck.
And 6 of them at least are dragons, so almost 7. So yeah, it's almost half.
Yeah, but this is still a good situation for Jackie Chan. Because now this Ragnaros has to be answered.
That's not a dragon.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Just have to trade in the Light Lord and develop Corruptor.
Yes. What about your 1-1? I guess you have to kill the 1-1.
Just Innerage. Maybe you Innerage the 1-1, so that way Frothing Berserker can connect.
Yeah, for free damage. You definitely want to kill the 1-1, because there is a slight chance Jackie Chan lacks 1 damage to finish your 9-1.
Yeah. But do you kill it with the Frothing Berserker attack, or do you kill it with the Innerage? I think you kill it with the Innerage.
Yeah, probably Innerage, because why would you need Innerage in this deck at this point? Like, you already spent it on Grommash. Like, Grommash is already spent.
You need it to kill a 1-1.
Yeah, and you need damage to face.
This turn. Oh,
he's keeping it.
Yeah.
That's extra free damage, I guess.
Okay. What can Jackie... Well, Enter the Colosseum.
Enter the Colosseum deals with most of this board, and...
And gets the True Sliver to finish off whatever survives, which is, in this case, the...
Crusher.
Draconid Crusher. And he's not afraid of taking that 9 damage because he still has Forbidden Healing.
Yes, and Warrior's almost out of cards.
Yeah.
So it seems like a pretty obvious play, but we'll see what Jackie Chan does. Yeah.
Enter the Coliseum.
It's pretty sick, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, it's great that the card is actually playable. Or at least played in competitive play at the moment.
Yeah. And I think Jackie Chan just turned the corner.
Whoa!
Oh, hello!
Maybe you said too soon.
Yeah.
Well, things just got interesting.
Can Ragnar slam Onyxia? Oh, wait. Well.
Oh, man.
How many Defrauda cards died this game? Not many. We haven't seen Sylvanas, we haven't seen Karn, we haven't seen the two freeze or whatever. So Nazoth is basically a 5-7 blank.
Yeah, that's right. There's no Death Rattles been played.
All right, so on the board at the moment, we have what, like 14 damage. If you heal for 20, you give yourself one more turn.
But all the damage is just going to come right back into you. So what are you going to draw that's going to protect you? Maybe you have to play Sylvanas and Forbidden Healing, which would bring you up to...
You can heal for 5 after Sylvanas using coin. So basically, like, you
heal for 5 10.
So 10, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's... He's going for the draw, it seems, for 4 mana. Well, Equality Pyromancer is
something good.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. That's minus 7 damage.
That was absolutely necessary.
Yeah, well, there was still the second Consecration as well. I mean, he didn't play an Alder either yet, so I assume there's 2 Alders in the deck, right?
Yeah.
I would just assume, naturally. But, yeah. So there were plenty of outs, considering that Jackie Chan only has... he had 12 cards left when he played that Solemn Vigil.
But it's also a big signal to Gaara that, hey, he doesn't have an AoE yet. No second Consecration, no Pyromancer. My 1-1s are still alive and can deal damage. So I think I like killing the 3-3 and maybe even killing the 1-1 here and just going 5 to face.
Yeah.
Or actually, can you just like kill the 1-1 with one of the 1-1s and then Inner-Rage Onyxia and just try to set up lethal? Yeah, just win as fast as possible.
Inner-Raging the Onyxia here seems pretty good.
There are Korkrons still in the deck.
There's still so much damage on the board for Gaara. Even though Aldra took away a lot of that.
6 plus 5, 11. You can actually deal 11 damage to face, and then if there is no heal, you might actually win with Korkron, even if the board is cleared. So I don't hate going for face with everything. Like, this is a face deck in the end.
Okay.
Oh man, so close. So close. There's obviously a heal on Tyrion now as well. Karn does nothing. Okay, so if you play Tyrion, do you ever lose? Like Tyrion, coin, forbidden, heal.
Were 2 executes played?
1. I think 1 was played. But like basically if you play Tyrion, coin, heal for 6, you get 11, you get Tyrion board, and then if Tyrion gets killed, like you just play Nazoth, get denied Tyrion.
Yeah.
Your opponent has no cards in hand.
And there's no way he can deal with 2. But I mean, Gaara's still pretty high health.
That's good as well.
Yeah, he's just gonna heal for 20. Why not? Nazoth's first mate.
Whoops.
Oh, no. Well, so he plays Nazoth's first mate and Inner Rage.
Isn't it the worst possible card you can get? Yeah, they mostly come together because like you want to have a better opening versus aggro decks.
Yeah, it's a really solid anti aggro build.
Yeah.
But against a Nazoth Paladin, definitely not what you want.
Yeah, Gaara is walking the plank at this very moment.
Jackie Chan looks incredibly nervous. And he went, after like his winner interview, after he won his last match, he went downstairs and he was like, said he wasn't expecting to be this nervous for this tournament, but was actually incredibly nervous.
It does get to
during
you.
His match. Yeah.
Yeah, Jackie Chan is still relatively new to this.
Yeah.
Whole experience.
And you're in solitude with your opponents behind a glass. Like for us, like chilling on the couch with no responsibility whatsoever. Yeah. We're cool. But yeah, he is there under a lot of stress.
Yeah.
Corruptor, not really exciting. It's still a minion, better than Azoth's first mate.
Yeah, I think Garou's just trying to think of what dragons he has left in this deck right now, and if the 3 damage is going to matter, and also if he can wait another turn before developing a 5-4. Because does he need the 3 damage from the Corruptor to get through this? Can he just attack in with one of the 1-1s, play the Corruptor as a 5-4, and then just pass the turn?
Yeah, that is a possibility.
Because there was a clear sign there's no AoE from before.
And also there's not much AoE left. There's 1 Consecration and 1 Pyromancer. There's no Qualities and there's no first Pyromancer, so...
Yeah, exactly. And you know, like, you have to win this game as fast as possible because at some point, those Defrile minions are going to come down and Azoth is going to be played.
Yeah. But he's just going to try and push through, play the 5-4.
Praying there's no Azoth. But...
Yeah, Azoth is so good.
There he is. He's going to come down for sure.
Like, you can even kill it with, kill 5-4 with the weapon. Can you stall still, like, and not play Azoth here? And just go, like, kill the 5-4 with the weapon and then play, I don't know, like, Doomsayer and Sylvanas?
I mean, at this point, it feels like he can do whatever he wants. And
yeah, exactly. At, like, 19.
He could hero power pass, and then just Azoth next turn and still win. Maybe not that much, but he's pretty far ahead.
Yeah, Azoth kind of wins at this very moment.
Yeah.
Anyway, just bringing Tyrion. You're at 14, pretty healthy. Onyxia as a free one. Those are
brought back a loot hoarder too.
True.
Yeah, I don't know. There's not really a way out for Garou. He's got like fairy dragons left in his deck, like maybe an Azure Drake.
He denies 2 durability points of the Ashbringer. That's something.
Sure. Yeah, that is something. And also, whoa, Jackie Chan has a dead card in his hand. True Server Champion. Can never play it.
But yeah, that's it. That's basically it. Garou can draw nothing that will help him unless Deathwing.
Surprise Deathwing.
Surprise Deathwing. He will be one off still with Deathwing.
Yeah, he's probably rethinking his choice of putting
Nyxia in. Even then, there's still the second Aldor waiting.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Garou.
That's it. Finley is not going to help him. Jackie Chan moves on to the second group stage.
Yeah.
Garou is eliminated.
Jackie Chan wins, and more importantly, another win for Team Anubis.
No, yeah. Team Anubis. We go back.
Weren't both these guys Anubis?
Garou was Horus, I think.
Look at the elation on Jackie Chan's face, man.
Yeah.
He really can't believe it.
Very happy.
Definitely. Let's get Jackie Chan here. Like, right. Let's ask him a couple of questions.
Can we give him the headset or?
I'm not Jackie Chan. No. He has. Oh, we can't give him a headset. All right.
You want a headset?
Trade with the mic. Like, take the mic from him. All right, so Jackie Chan.
Hey, man.
Hey.
You seem excited. You just played a match of Hearthstone. Was it that special?
I mean, how tense can you get? Oh, it was that was taking everything out of me. I got no energy left. Like, even though I'm just sitting there, but like.
Did you change your strategy at all? Like, since you played Garou before, did you take anything away from the first match that you brought into the second match?
Not really, because I stuck to banning the Shaman and opening with the Mage.
Yeah.
Because my Mage was, like, good against pretty much his whole lineup, really. The Zoo's kind of 50-50. But,
yeah.
Thankfully, I managed to win it this time.
Oh, so you think it's 50-50 for... Versus Zoo, you think it's 50-50?
Yeah.
I think so now.
I think so. I run Double Flame Strike and, like, a slightly more aggressive list, so I can contest the board a bit more early, but... Yeah.
And then, what did you think was the matchup, Warrior versus Paladin, which was the last one, the most important one? Did you think, like, Garou is favored, or are you favored in the matchup?
No, I think the Paladin's favored, but when he played the Onyxia, I got really worried after that. I thought it was over, and I was like, oh, no, Onyxia, I've just used my Enter the Colosseum.
Yeah, Enter the Colosseum is actually pretty sick, though.
Yeah,
like, every single time you've used it today, it's done a lot of work.
Yeah, it's really good against aggressive decks, which is what I'm bringing the Azoth Paladin to beat. So.
Yeah, people look at it as, like, a worse brawl, but it's still a brawl, right?
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, you have, like, the Aldor, and you can run Humility, which works well with it.
Yeah.
So, you just said that you brought Azoth Paladin to counter aggro, but why Azoth Paladin? Did you really like the deck, or did you want to bring something specific, like Jackie Chan approved?
Well, I... Because, obviously... people associate with me, like Yogg and that kind of thing. So I've got like Temper Mage and Yogg Druid, but I do want to take it seriously. And like, I really think the Zoth Paladin is a very strong deck. And I think some people underrate it a little bit.
Yeah.
I really think it's strong. And I think the End of the Colosseum actually has a big impact on the aggro matchups. So
you might very well be the only person in the tournament who actually believes that, since you haven't really seen any Zoth Paladins.
Yeah,
so
no, I mean, it's done really well for me today. Yeah. Like, yeah, I'm really liking it.
Yeah, I mean, the results prove you're right. So
I've seen like 12 players now, I think, advance. Out of the players that you've seen move on to the next group stage, so move on. Who are you afraid of?
I'm afraid of Life Coach. He wrecked me earlier. Yeah, but yeah, everyone seems really strong. But
well, I don't think you can be in the same group as him since you were in his first group.
Okay.
So I don't think it's possible for you to be in the
next.
Do
you know who I would be against?
I have no idea.
I haven't
hard to say at this point,
Not Life Coach.
I haven't looked that far ahead. I wasn't actually expecting to do this.
Yeah, I don't think they're drafted while everybody's moved on, but at least you can avoid Life Coach for one more round.
Yeah,
you can make it to top 8 and not have to face Life Coach.
Yeah. That'd be great.
That's absolutely possible.
I'll try my best.
Yeah. Are you scared of Frodan?
Well, I'll just banish Shaman and I'll be fine.
Nobody knows
what the Death Star.
Shots fired.
I mean, Gara had the control Shaman. I just didn't want to play against it.
Yeah.
So I just banned it.
Yeah.
It's so interesting that we have those new decks like Nazoth Paladin, Conceit Shaman being actually a threatening deck at the moment.
Yeah.
It's like the scariest deck. Nobody here wants to play against it.
It's an awesome meta game right now we're living in.
Yeah, it's really good. Like the control shaman seems to be taking the meta by storm. Like so many people have brought it. Like you haven't seen my shaman deck, but
ooh, we assume it's Conceit Shaman, but you don't have to.
It's
hidden tech.
You'll see. You'll see.
Like Aggro Shaman.
All right.
But who knows?
I'm excited to see you tomorrow.
Yeah.
But we still have more Hearthstone for you today, guys. That will be it from this table here. But there is something happening at the poker table at this very moment, so let's check that out.
All right, welcome back to yet another Seat Story Cup Battle of the Gods mini game between Team Anubis and Team Horse. Now, Tice is here for Team Anubis together with Stan Sivka. Wow, a lot of Anubis fans. And obviously, Tice, a veteran at these mini games already. You lost the last one, right? All right, and then we got Hot Form and Terrence. And we're going to play Bite Me. You don't get any applause? Actually, use the mic. What'd you say?
I said all the Europeans here cheering for Anubis.
That's totally biased, though.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so this is Frank right here, okay? And Frank is protecting his bones. Now, the objective is to steal his bones without him knowing, all right? So there are some cards. Where are the cards, actually? Oh, right here. So we're going to flip one of these cards, and it's going to have a figure on it. So let's see what it says. So that's one blue bone. So the objective for each team is to get one blue bone. And the first one that gets bit and loses the round, and the other team gains 200 points. We're going to do that 5 times. Are you ready, guys? I think you are. Okay, so we're going to start with Stan. Let's get one blue bone for Team Anubis. He's snoring. Oh, close one. Don't make Frank angry.
I don't even get there, man.
Are there even enough blue bones? Be careful, Terrence. Dude, Tice is like so scared. Get the blue one. Get the blue one. If there's no blue ones left, we flip another card. Oh, be careful. Ooh, put the red one back. Get the blue one. Oh, he noticed though. Red odd form. There's a... there's a couple of blue ones left.
Right by his face.
Don't scare him too much. Oh, okay, clinical. All right, back to you, Sam.
Yeah, you should probably switch now.
You should probably switch? Okay, let's switch. Okay, one red bone. God, you guys are too careful. You guys are too good at this. Oh. Go on. He knows. He knows, Tice. Shaking?
No.
You're not shaking? Alright. That's a loss for Team Anubis. So 200 points to Team Horus for that one. That was round number one. So let's reset Frank right here. That doesn't count, of course.
Right, are we going, do I start now or do we start again?
Let's start with you this time. So the other way around.
Come on.
Okay, two bones this time. It's two white ones. Two white bones. All right, there's one. Two white bones. In case there's none left, we're gonna put back those two. Oh, he knows. All right. Two white ones, Sam. Oh! Damn, man. Team Horus gaining those points. It's the second round to you guys. So 400 points already. Team Anubis really has to step it up. Come on, Tice. You can do it. So turn starts this time. What do we have? Three white bones.
Come on, there's no way to fix it. There's no way. Did you make this?
Please fuck it up.
Three white bones. Oh, there's the first one. Galfram, how scared are you for your teammate right now?
I think he's doing pretty good, actually. I think Tice is the weak link over here. He's getting a little nervous.
No.
Is that so, Tice?
A little bit, maybe. A little bit.
He already has two.
I can get a new one now, right? Like, there are almost no whites left.
There's only three whites left in there.
Only one more left. Only one more. It's really close. The reset. Oh, he's shaking so much. He got. Oh, watch out for Frank.
I get a new card?
Yeah, no, this is fine, because it's three yellow ones, so that's totally fine. Let's go for three yellow ones this time. Sam, do you believe in your teammate?
You're gonna make it, but be patient.
Let's go, Anubis!
Woo! All right, there's the
Come
first
on, only
one.
Two more. Go.
Okay. Two now. I have no idea how this dog can sleep through all of this, but... Unleash the hounds. God damn it, Frank. Oh! Wow. That's the third round in a row, man. That's brutal. That is brutal. So only got two to pick it up. Alright. Right, Oddform, you start. Two yellow bones. Put that one back in. Put that one back in somewhere.
Come on, Doki, wake up. Wake up.
Yes. Alright.
He's stealing your bones. Come on.
Two yellow ones.
Oh, Frank.
Come on, Frank. Alright. There's the two. Stan. Okay, so this is the first time. Horus is in the lead, by the way, in the overall points ranking, so...
What's this? Well, last time I also fucked up.
For the day, though, so... Not right now. Close one.
Oh, he stopped.
Guys, come on, help your teammate.
Come on, please.
Oh, my God! Brutal. So that's four rounds in a row, guys. Frank is just trolling.
Can you guys give us a round? Like. I will start.
All right, let's see. are we getting? One white one. Okay, this should go over pretty fast, right? Oh my god! Carded!
Yes!
Okay.
Frank is from NA, for sure.
So Frank's running. Okay, hot for him. So you won five out of five rounds.
Yes.
So that's 1,000 points.
I can safely say we win the Battle of the Gods today. Oh,
wow.
Feels good.
Carnage right there. Tice, man. That's the second minigame you've participated in.
I think I just got cooked. The team just doesn't want me in these minigames. And I can understand that. I accept it. And I will retire. It's up for our newcomers to now get in the games and do their best. I also don't want anymore, so.
Oh, wow. Okay. Terrence, are you going to participate in some more?
Yeah, definitely. Tice may have beaten me 2 times in our series, but we 5-0'd him in the dog game, so I definitely feel better about that now.
Oh, wow. All right. Well, that was pretty fun, guys. Thanks for watching that. And we're going to have a lot more exciting minigames over the course of the weekend, of course. You can also get the tweets going on for your team to actually support them. So it's 5 points for each tweet and 2 points for each retweet of that. So be sure to tweet with either hashtag Team Anubis or hashtag Team Horus. Team Anubis definitely needs help after losing 1,000 points to the other team. So keep them rolling in and stick with us after this short break. You're going to see the next group. I think it's Eloise versus Forsen, actually. So that's going to be pretty sick. See you after the break, guys.